So good morning, everyone. I welcome you all for the good morning test. So here today we'll be discussing the daily current affairs. I hope you took the test in the app. So in this initiative, we'll be identifying 10 current affairs areas from the previous day's newspaper and various other sources, and we'll be converting that into a prelims question, and we'll be discussing all those 10 prelims questions with respect to preliminary examinations point of view, and we'll also be identifying an editorial and converting that into a mains question and discussing that with respect to mains answer rating point of view. So this is the brief idea regarding this initiative. So today I have another 5 to 10 questions for the day. So let us discuss. So it was a good surprise today morning after seeing the test match team. So our Tamil Nadu player Natarajan got another debut chance. So it is a good surprising day early morning. Okay. So the first question for the day is about the entomophagy. So today, we have identified almost 4 questions from environment. So there would be a lot of questions from environment today. So that is a speciality of today. And recently the term entomophagy is seen in news. It refers to what? So entomophagy is a habit of eating insects. So it is a behavior where people will be consuming the insects. So there is a huge taboo with respect to insect eating behavior. So people will think that it is not good, that it is not good to watch, or it is aruverpu thakkada irukum. So it is not palatable. So all these complaints are there with respect to consumption of insects. But according to various researchers and other things, consumption of insects which are permitted to consume are good for health. So there have been many researchers in the recent times which says that consumption of insects is good for health, and there is a huge protein and fiber in it, which could be very nutritious for the person. Instead of consuming the chicken or mutton or beef, consumption of insects is considerably healthier. So that is what the researchers have been found. And I think so Bear Grylls will be very happy now. So that is what it is, promoting the insect eating benefit of indigenous people. If you could see, this is the thing. So all the insects are almost very high in protein, crickets and grasshoppers are considered to be very highly rich in proteins. Here we are having crickets and grasshopper. So here we are having crickets and grasshopper, and here we are having caterpillar. So all are considered to be very rich. So why this is considered to be most good now? Because of this meat industry, there has been a huge global warming. So because at one side, this poultry or the cattle or the livestock which are used in the meat industry emit a lot of greenhouse gases. So that is contributing to global warming. On the other hand, these cattle or livestock, when we grow them, they consume a lot of land and fodder, and they consume a lot of water. So during their entire life cycle, they would have consumed thousands of liters of water. So in order to produce 1 kg of meat, we are spending so much water and so much resources. So it is considerably not eco-friendly. So compared to the insects consume less amount of ecological space. So if we start consuming more insects, that will be ecologically feasible. So that is what the new opinion which is being going on, especially with respect to environment impact. So in order to reduce the environment impact and to cater the protein demand for the growing population, it is always better to increase the insects consumption instead of just having meat. So that is what the recent research is. And recently, European Union also approved mealworm consumption. So European Union Food Agency recently approved mealworm consumption. So that was also in news. So mealworms are worms which are used for consumption, which is being approved for human consumption. So recently that was also in news. So both the things are covered here. So if you could see, there are many societies. So actually this stigma or this hatred or this this wrong impression regarding the insect consumption is a very recent phenomenon which came during the colonial times because of the British. But if you could see previously, for the thousands of years, we are consuming insects. And if you see a lot of tribes now, still they consume insects. A lot of tribes in eastern Himalayas and northeastern India, still they are consuming the a lot of insects. So Ahom community, so we are Mishing tribe in so Mishing tribe is one tribe which is consuming. Then we are having Ahom community of Assam. They are consuming a lot of insects, and they and if you could see, they are also making a red ant chutney. This red ant chutney is very famous. It is considered to be very spicy. So in a lot of food shows also, this red ant chutney has come. So next, Nagas, Manipur, and Assam, they are also consuming a lot of termites or in pre-popal stage, or airy silkworm, or hornets, grubs. So all these kind of insects are being consumed by the tribes in the northeastern India still today. So it is time for us to remove the stigma and start consuming in order to be eco-friendly. So that is what the article is talking. So the second question is about the, so just note down this keyword, because last time they gave a keyword like this and asked what it is. So in the similar way, they can ask here also. So last time they gave, what do you mean by the term fertigation? So they just gave the term and they just asked what it is. So like that, they can ask, what do you mean by the term entomophagy? Entomophagy is consumption of insects, because European Union has approved consumption of mealworms. So that's why it is in use. So next is, consider the following statement regarding lumpy skin disease. So this lumpy skin disease is an animal disease. So it is a disease which comes to the cattle. Okay, cattle or livestock, they are affected by this disease. It is a viral disease. It is a kind of a chicken pox. It is a kind of a pox which comes to the cattle. So when humans are having pox, we call it a chicken pox or smallpox. If the same kind of pox variety, if it affects the animals like cow or buffalo, it is called as lumpy skin disease, because they'll be getting lumps all over their body. So that is the logic here. So it is an infectious disease, affects the cattle, caused by the virus. It is a zoonotic disease. So it is not a zoonotic disease. Zoonotic disease means those disease which can be transmitted from animal to human. A disease which originated in an animal is being transmitted to human, and it is being transmitted to human to human. So this is called a zoonotic disease. There should be a transmission from animal to human. So that is called a zoonotic disease, but this is just an animal disease and it is not transmitted to humans. So if a disease which is originating in animal is transmitted only among animals, it is not called a zoonotic. It should transfer from animal to human, then only it is called a zoonotic. So it is not a zoonotic disease. So second statement is wrong. So naturally the answer will be C. It spreads easily through the vectors like mosquito on flies or ticks, which are blood sucking mosquitoes. It is being transmitted by these mosquitoes. So that is one trend here. Okay, if a mosquito, if it bites a cow which is affected by this lumpy skin disease, if the same mosquito bites another cow, then it will transfer from cow to cow. So it is these lumps will be coming first. If the treatment is not given properly, those lumps will develop into a very big wound, and that will degrade the flesh. And it is almost having 60% mortality rate. Sorry, 60 or 40, let us check. It is having a huge mortality rate compared to other diseases. In India, we are not having treatment for this. So virus is a host. So this is a new epidemic which has outbreaked in Kerala again. So in Kerala, we are seeing two important outbreaks now. One, we are seeing bird flu, and other thing is lumpy skin disease among cattle. But luckily, this disease is not affecting human beings, not as contagious as COVID. So I'm sorry, it is having a... just a second. So 10% of the animals die because of this disease. If there is a disease, 10% of the animals are dying because of it. It first originated in Africa. Until past few decades, it was confined only to Africa and was spreading only within the Africa. But in recent times, it is also started spreading in various places and various other countries also. So that is the recent change which took place. Just a second. With respect to lumpy skin disease, so lumpy skin disease is a viral disease. Any disease when we study, we have to first identify whether it is a viral disease or bacterial disease or a parasitic disease. So that is the first thing which you have to identify. Okay. Next one is about the olive ridley sea turtle. So recently, olive ridley sea turtles are the, it is a kind of a marine turtle which are visiting from Pacific or Indian or Atlantic Ocean to the Indian coast. So they visit the Gahir Mata Wildlife Sanctuary in Odisha, where they are having this behavior, where women turtles will visit the seashore and they will dig a hole of up to 1 feet or 1.5 feet and lay eggs. Okay. They will come. So this is called as nesting. Nesting means this large number of turtles will visit the Gahir Mata Wildlife Sanctuary and they will be laying eggs after digging a pit. So after the laying eggs, they'll go back to the ocean and they will go to their herds. So after, these eggs will be hatched in the warmth of the beach. Once they are hatched, the hatchlings or the tortoises or the small turtles will swim back to ocean and they will find their parents in the ocean. So that is the phenomenon. So it is an interesting thing how these small turtles are finding their parents again when they enter the ocean. So that is a very huge question. So this is the behavior. So this is called as the aribada. So this is also called as aribada. So aribada is nothing but mass nesting of Olive Ridley sea turtles on the coast of on the seashores is called as aribada. So it is a technical term given from some tribal origin. So just note down. They can also ask the term aribada is referred to what. So why it is in use recently? Olive Ridley's are in use recently because of the marine pollution and plastic pollution. The plastic which we are throwing is going and affecting them. But it was in use recently because a lot of sea turtles were picked from the Odisha coast and they were tagged with the GPS. So tagging with the GPS means they will just attach a small device on the turtles. So when these turtles are coming for laying eggs, after laying eggs, these researchers identified them and they tagged them. So and this year they are planning to tag almost 30,000 turtles. So why are we tagging them? In order to identify their migrating patterns, in order to study their migrating patterns, in order to understand where they go. So we are studying it. So this is the brief news behind this Olive Ridley turtles. After 25 years, we are tagging this. So earlier we tagged them in 90s. Now we are tagging after 25 years. So it is a medium-sized species found only in the tropical waters of Pacific and Indian Ocean. So that is the first statement. If you could see here, this is the distribution of Olive Ridley sea turtles. So it is not only located in Indian Ocean and Pacific Ocean, but also in the Atlantic Ocean. So it is also there in Atlantic Ocean. That is one thing. And these red dots indicate the major spots where they come and lay eggs. So apart from Odisha here, another major spot where they are laying eggs is Mexico, Costa Rica coast. So Mexico and Costa Rica coast is another hot spot where they are laying eggs. So which we have to note. So these are all the mother Olive Ridleys who are coming to the shore in order to lay eggs. And these are all the small hatchlings who are coming out of the eggs and finding their way back. So if you could see, there is a beautiful movie called Finding Nemo. In Finding Nemo also, we'll see this Olive Ridley turtles only will be helping them to find the route back to Australia. So that is one thing. So it is found only in tropical waters of Pacific and Indian Ocean. They are given it is found only there. So it's wrong. It is also found in the Atlantic waters. So naturally, the answer is going to be 2 because you are eliminating 1. After the first statement itself, we got the answer. So you no need to read the other 2 statements also, but still we will read because of the verification. These turtles are carnivorous. Yes, of course, turtles are carnivorous. They will be consuming other fishes and other small marine organism. It is listed as vulnerable in the IUCN Red List. Yes, and Appendix 1 of CITES. So Appendix 1 of CITES means you cannot trade them. So CITES means it is a convention for trade of endangered species. So if an animal is placed in the appendix of CITES means you cannot trade it. Then Schedule 1 of Wildlife Sanctuary, it is a protection given within the India. So there are 3 lists here. One is IUCN Red List, another thing is Appendix List, and CITES List, another thing is Wildlife Protection Act. Okay. So they are planning to tag almost 30,000 turtles. So that is the thing. So they have started tagging this thing. So in order to identify and get the information regarding reproductive biology and movements of their growth rates. So that is one thing. They are carnivorous, and note down this word, aribada. Aribada is a phenomenon where unique mass nesting phenomenon is called as aribada. So Gahir Mata in Odisha and Mexico and Costa Rica are the 2 important places where they do the mass nesting. So the next question is regarding the Great Green Wall. So this Great Green Wall is not actual wall like the one which is being discussed by Donald Trump. So Great Green Wall is nothing but a belt of trees. So in Africa, they are planning to construct a belt of trees in Sahel region. So what is Sahel region? So Sahel region is this region. So this is the African map. And if you could see, this is Sahel region. So Sahel region is a transition region between the Sahara Desert in the north. We are having Sahara in the north, and we are having equatorial rainforest in the south. So this is here where the equator is going, and we are having equatorial rainforest here, which is very dense, and we are having Sahara Desert in the north, which is very very dry and very arid. So in between the Sahara Desert to equatorial rainforest, we are having this transition region called Sahel. So this region is called as Sahel, or it is also called as savanna, tropical savanna. So this Sahel or tropical savanna region consists of grasslands. So it is considered to be one of the most affected region by the process of desertification. So desertification is process of conversion of normal lands into desert land. So that is called as desertification. Conversion of normal forest into desert land is called as desertification. And this is one of the hugely affected area because of desertification. And how it is being affected? Because of spreading of Sahara. Sahara is slowly spreading southwards and the size of the Sahara is extending. Since the Sahara is extending, it is capturing the good regions in the south. So because of this, the grasslands are being destroyed and it is affecting the ecosystem and it is affecting the biodiversity. So that is a problem here. In order to stop it, how can you stop the desertification? How can you stop the movement of mud or soil erosion? By planting trees. So that is the plan here. So they are planning to plant trees along the Sahel region, starting from Senegal. From Senegal to Djibouti, they are planning to construct this huge wall. If you could see this yellow thing, this is the wall which they are planning to construct. It is going to be 30,000 kilometer long wall of trees, full of trees, which is having 15 kilometer width. So the width will be 15 kilometer and the length is going to be 30 kilometer. So it will be covering from Senegal, Mauritania. So just note down the countries which are located in the Sahel region. This can also be a map question. Which of the following countries are part of the Sahel region? Mauritania, Senegal, Mali, Burkina Faso, Niger, Nigeria, Chad, Sudan, Eritrea, Ethiopia, Djibouti. So these are all the nations through which this wall is going to pass. So this construction of this wall is an initiative of African Union. So African Union is a major thing. And recently, since they had this, they didn't have enough money to construct. So France government decided to give a huge donation. France government decided to take up almost 40% of the funding cost. Like how British ruled India, France was the major power which was ruling Africa during the colonial time. So they are showing interest there. And apart from this, World Bank is also contributing some funds. So initiative, it is an initiative of African Union with the help of France, and World Bank is also contributing. So this is this great green wall of Africa. The thing which you have to note is the countries through which it is passing. And characteristics of Sahel region, they are not going to ask about this wall in the preliminary. Instead of this wall, they might ask, the Great Green Wall is found in which continent? Like that they can ask. Or apart from that, if you could see, the main focus will be on the map, the countries through which it is passing, or the characteristics of Sahel region and savanna of Africa. As a geography question, they will be asking. So this is how you should be prepared for such questions. The Great Green Wall Project, okay, so we'll continue. So let us continue quickly. There was a power cut here. So it was launched in 2007 by African Union. So that is true. It aims to make Sahel green again by restoring the degraded land. So they are going to restore the degraded lands of the Sahel by constructing a huge wall. So that is the main idea of the project now. Okay, so... and providing livelihood to the people. So Emmanuel Macron almost decided to contribute $14 billion. So France is going to contribute $40 billion for this project. So Great Green Wall, it is going to be along the south border of Sahara. So it is going to be south of the Sahara, north of the equatorial rainforest. So that is the thing. It is almost 8.2 million hectares. It is a land restoration project where they are going to restore the land. It amounts to nearly 42%. So 33% is the total budget. Of the 33 budget, Emmanuel Macron is contributing 14 billion. So that is the thing here. And World Bank is having an initiative called Pro Green Initiative. So through this Pro Green Initiative, they are finding the greening project. Wherever the afforestation project is going on along the world, World Bank will be funding that project through Pro Green Initiative. Through Pro Green Initiative, they are also funding this. So there can be another question regarding Pro Green. So what is this Pro Green Initiative? This Pro Green Initiative is an initiative of World Bank for afforestation project. So that's it. So Pro Green is an effort to address the landscape degradation. Those countries which are funding for landscape to restore the lands which were degraded. So it is 8,000. I said 30,000. It is 8,000 kilometer long and 15 kilometer wide. Most 8,000 kilometer long and 15,000 kilometer. So that is the nation's. It is not only going to provide livelihood for the people. So that control almost 250 million tons of carbon to act as a great thing which is going to happen. The carbon which was emitted. So that is another thing which you have. Yeah. So we discussed about the stages recently. Your voice is breaking. Oh. So, okay, So next we are going to see about the light combat aircraft Tejas. So recently, Government of India decided to procure this light combat aircraft called Tejas from the Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. They are going to procure almost 83 aircraft. So Tejas is a light combat aircraft. So what is the meaning of light combat aircraft? So it is going to be a light variant. It is not going to be a heavy aircraft. It is going to be a light variant, which is going to quick and fast and small. So that is the main thing. It is an indigenously developed aircraft developed by Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. So Hindustan Aeronautics Limited is a public sector enterprise which is being managed by Ministry of Defense. So this Hindustan Aeronautics Limited is constructing this Tejas light combat aircraft, indigenously designed, developed and manufactured, state of art fourth generation aircraft. Yes, it is fourth generation. What is the difference between fourth and fifth and third generation? Means it is an advanced variations and new advanced features will be added. So that is the different thing. So there will be increase in speed, there will be increase in endurance, there will be increase in capabilities. So that is the variations with respect to first generation, second generation and third generation. Okay. So it is the first indigenously designed, developed and manufactured category procurement of combat aircraft with indigenous content of 50% and progressively it will reach to 60% by the end of program. Yes. So see, actually under the defense procurement procedure, it is the first indigenously designed, developed. So there is this category called indigenously developed, designed, developed and manufactured category in the defense procurement procedure. So it is the first aircraft to be procured under this category. So this defense procurement procedure came recently. So based on that procedure only, they are acquiring it. So this is the first aircraft which are going to procure under this model. So that is the thing, the second statement stage. So it is having almost 50% indigenous content. So of the manufacturing took place in India, but the raw material is having almost 50% local sourcing, and they are going to increase it to 60% in the future. So that is the basic thing. So this is the Tejas aircraft. So yesterday I asked the prelims thesis question in our Telegram channel. I hope you would have seen it. It is a tailless model. If you could see, there is no tail here. It is just a delta wing. The wing is extending till the end. So that is the thing. And it is single engine. So single engine tailless model or delta model. If you could see, it is in the shape of delta. So you know the delta is nothing but a triangle. So it is in the shape of a delta. So it is delta wing tailless model. So because you are not having a tail here, if there is a tail, means you will be having something like this in the tails also. So that is not present here. If you could see F-16 or MiG, it will be having tails. So it is a tailless model. So that is one thing, tailless single engine, double seater. There is a single seater and there is a double seater variant also. And it is a supersonic. So it is a supersonic capabilities. It can reach up to 1.6 to 1.8 max speed. Supersonic means faster than the speed of the sound. So if you could compare it with other aircrafts, it is considerably less, because there are hypersonic aircrafts also like F-16 or F-18. But still, it is a light combat aircraft of supersonic variant. That is one thing. It was so another interesting feature is about this Tejas is that it was launched in 1980. So there was this scheme program called Light Combat Aircraft Procurement Program. It was started in 1984 by Indira Gandhi, and they decided to construct an indigenous light combat aircraft. And if you could see, they almost finished the design in 1999, and they brought in the first prototype in 2003 when Vajpayee was Prime Minister, and he gave the name called Tejas. It was earlier called Light Combat Aircraft, and Tejas was given name given by Vajpayee. So it is not the first supersonic aircraft designed by HAL. It is the second supersonic aircraft designed by HAL. We are having Maruts, which is the first variant. Yesterday we discussed, we saw that in the prelims teasers also. So whenever there is a defense thing, you have to read it holistically in all the aspects. You should study all the features detailed, because there might be a question. If you could see previous year, in many cases, they have asked some defense initiatives. Which of the following countries is the first one to approve the insects for human food consumption? So actually, there is some error in the question framing. So European Safety Agency recently approved consumption of insects. So which of the following insects is the first one to be approved? Instead of insect, there is this word called country given in the question. Which of the following insects is the first one approved for human consumption by European Food Safety Agency. So that is nothing but mealworms. So European Food Safety Agency has approved the consumption of mealworms recently. It is also called as yellow gerb. Yellow gerb is actually the name of the insects. Insect. It will be it's the most favorite insect of Bear Grylls too. It will look like a caterpillar. So this yellow gerb is given approval for the human consumption. And after given approval for human consumption, it is called as mealworm. It is called as mealworm because you can consume it for a meal. So mealworm is the marketing name and yellow gerb is the technical name of the insect. So that is the difference between the two. So please note down yellow gerb and mealworm. So no need to study in detail about it. Just know what is what, that level. So next one is about the Howbara bustard. Howbara bustard is a vulnerable species. Actually, it is not critically endangered. I think so. It is vulnerable species. So that's why second statement is wrong here. It is a kind of a bustard. So bustard is a kind of a crane variety. It will look like a crane bustard. We all know we are having great Indian bustard along the coast of Rajasthan. Sorry, along the border of Rajasthan in the Rajasthan desert. So it is a desert bird. So this bustard species of bird is considered to be, they are believing that if you consume the meat of this bird, your ability to have a good performance in the sex will be increased. So there is this belief. So that's why it is also considered to be a symbol of masculinism. So masculinity or macho masculinity means where the men will be showing their abusive behavior, that they are men, naamlada, and the mari kind of a behavior. So since in order to prove their masculinity, these men will come and they will be hunting this bird and they will be consuming the meat, thinking that it will increase their performance. So that is what the myth which is associated is just a myth. It is not having those capabilities in reality. So this myth is being believed by the crown prince and other Arab rulers. So these Arab rulers are traditionally they are having the habit of coming to the desert and hunting this bird and eating it. So they are having this habit, but now because of this over hunting, without of this uncontrolled over hunting in India. So this hunting took place in India also. Indian kings, a lot of Indian kings in the Rajasthan and Haryana region, they also started hunting this bird for the same purposes. In India, they were hunting this great Indian bustard. So that's why this great Indian bustard got critically endangered. How it got critically endangered? Because the Indian king started to hunt it. So after once it entered into critically endangered, we started to protect it. Similarly, this is another, Howbara bustard is another bird which is located in Pakistan, which is also now being threatened by the royal families of the Arab nations. So they wanted to hunt it down. So if you could see the level of hunting, it goes almost in thousands. So in 2014, in one hunting season, one prince alone killed almost 2,000 birds. He almost killed 2,000 birds. Avlo bird saapiduveyada adhuve theriyadhu. So but he's killing it. So that is the thing here. So this is an image. This is how they will be killing it and they will be showing it in the display. Actually, it is a private event. It will not be televised or it should not be shot, but this is one image which got leaked. So recently Imran Khan gave permission for the Arab royals in order to hunt it. Okay, so so generally this Pakistan government will give them permit up to 100 persons. So one person can kill up to 100 birds. That is a permit being given to each person. So recently Imran Khan gave this permit to the royal family. So Imran Khan, when he was in opposition, he was criticizing the government for giving this permit. Now when he came to power, he is also giving the permit. So this is the normal, usual trait of a politician. Every time when you are in opposition, you oppose. When you are in ruling party, you support. So that is the behavior of all parties, and the same thing happening there also. And another thing, another interesting thing about this is, in 2015, the Supreme Court of Pakistan banned the hunting. The Supreme Court of Pakistan banned the hunting in 2015, but Pakistan government said that please don't ban it. It will affect the diplomatic relations between the Arab nations and Pakistan if you are banning the hunting. So the royal family will be angered there. So that's why we have to allow. So those kind of pressure are being exerted under the Pakistan. So Pakistan should take measure like Indian government did. At least like Indian government acted in very delayed manner. That's why it went into critically endangered status. Now it is just in vulnerable status. Now Indian government should handle it now. So it is vulnerable in the, Pakistan government should take a decision and stop, like how Indian government made it, gave it the protected status. So that is what the thing is. So Howbara bustard is vulnerable and it is located in the Gandhara region. So next one is about the festival which we celebrated yesterday, Pongal. It is being called in various names in various states. So based on that, there is this match the following. Festival-based question is being asked by UPSC since 2018, 19 and 20. In all 3 years, we had a festival-based question. So that's why these festival names should and the states where it is celebrated should be known. In all the questions, they are just asked the festivals and states. So Lohri is in Punjab. Magar Sankranti is celebrated across India in various states like Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. And Madhya Pradesh also, it is called as Magar Sankranti. In Uttarayan is a fin which is celebrated in Gujarat. So Uttarayan is not Uttar Pradesh. In Uttar Pradesh also, it is called as Sankranti only. But Uttarayan is celebrated in Gujarat. So Uttarayan is nothing but the kite festival. So in Gujarat, they will be doing this kite. There is this movie called Bana Katadi of Adarva. There they will be showing that Uttarayan festival of Gujarat. Then Magh Bihu. So Magh Bihu is Assam and Makara Vilakku is a festival of Kerala. So which is related to Ayyappan, Lord Ayyappan. So these are all the festivals and there is a list which is being given there. Only third one is wrongly matched. So with that we can come to this answer. So you just see the factual name of all these festivals which is given here. So it is called as Pongal in Tamil Nadu or Paush Porbon in Bengal and Maghi in Haryana. Sinkrat is in Kashmir. In Kashmir, it is called as Sinkrat. In Madhya Pradesh, it is called as Sukarat. So there are various names in which it is being called. In Madhya Pradesh also, they are celebrating Sankranti and Sukarat also. So just note down the names. So the next one is Jayant Kumar Dash Committee. So recently, Reserve Bank of India appointed a committee called Jayant Kumar Dash Committee. So in the name itself, he's having a dash. Okay, so dashing guy. So this Jayant Kumar Dash, dashing guy committee is appointed mainly because of the digital lending menace, which is being done recently. Recently, we saw a lot of digital lending app started to misuse the people's need for money and they started to exploit them and they even abused them and that also led to a lot of suicides. So because of this, many states, there was an outrage to ban these apps and RBI should regulate. So that's why, see, actually digital lending is not a wrong thing. So digital lending should be regulated in a proper way like RBI regulates the bank. So, but there was a demand for a blanket bank or ban on digital lending. There are many digital lending apps which are genuine too. Because of the many illegal ones which sprang up because of the lack of regulatory procedures. So the main issue which you have to note with respect to digital lending is there was no regulatory procedures. There was no regulation. Because of this lack of regulation, a lot of illegal apps started to come and they started to exploit. Because of it, they are asking, people were asking us for a total ban of all digital lending. So all digital lending might affect the genuine players also. Digital lending is nothing but there will be an online app. Through that app, you can demand for the loan. You can upload all your documents and ask for the loan. And through that app itself, they'll approve the loan and give the money to your bank account. So you no need to visit a bank for getting approval of loan. Through online app itself, you can get the loan. So that is digital lending. But so RBI, in order to alleviate it, RBI also decided not to ban it entirely, but it is planning to regulate it. So in order to regulate, we need ideas how to regulate. For that only, they have appointed a committee under the chairmanship of Jayant Kumar Dash, who was also executive director of RBI. So this committee is responsible for evaluate the digital lending activities and legitimacy of these activities and identify the risk posed by such activities and also this committee will also probe into the growth of digital lending in India. So that is thing. All these things will be done. So it is going to propose what are all the various regulatory measures which should be applied by the digital lending app, and it will also going to sell how we can grow and increase the financial inclusion. See, digital lending is nothing but which is going to create the financial inclusion also. That aspect also we should not leave. So just note down the name of the committee. It is Jayant Kumar Dash Committee. So the last question for the day is about the Supreme Court. Again, it is taken from the previous year, 2014. The power of the Supreme Court of India to decide the disputes between the center and state falls under original jurisdiction of Supreme Court. Under original jurisdiction only, any cases relating to center and states or center and few states at one side versus another state or between a state and state. So all these issues, if there is an issue between one state and other state or center and state, then any of the party can go and file a case in the Supreme Court under Article 131 Article 131 of the Constitution allows for the original jurisdiction of Supreme Court. Original jurisdiction means only they have the jurisdiction. So if a court is the, if only they are having the exclusive jurisdiction, that is called as original jurisdiction. So that is the logic here. So based on this original jurisdiction only, they are planning to... So recently, the various cases filed against the Citizenship Amendment Act or the cases filed against the farm bills, everything was filed under this Article 131 only. So let us quickly discuss the DAS question for the day. We have come to the end of the GMT questions. Let us quickly finish the DAS question because we are not having the proper internet connection because of the power shutdown. Data can be an asset for governance. So the statement is data can be an asset for governance, growth and public welfare. Elaborate. So this is the statement which was given by Mr. Amitabh Kant. Who's Amitabh Kant? Amitabh Kant is the CEO of Niti Aayog. So Niti Aayog CEO, yesterday in an editorial in Hindustan Times, he gave this statement. And Niti Aayog also recently released a detailed report called DESA. So DESA is digital empowerment, data empowerment and security architecture. So this DESA is a initiative which was launched recently. So the full abbreviation of DESA is Data Empowerment and Protection Architecture. Okay, Data Empowerment and Protection Architecture is a recent document. It is a recent document released by Niti Aayog where they talk about how data can be used as a resource, how data can be used as a resource for the human welfare. So based on this report only, in that report, they will be talking about how this data can be used as a resource for human welfare and how it can be used for the governance and how it can be used for the overall welfare of the nation. So they would have discussed in detail about this. So from this only, they have taken this statement. So I'm just giving you the background from where the question was taken. So yeah, the question talks about data can be an asset. It can be an asset for governance at one side, then growth and public welfare. So elaborate. So in this question, they are asking us how the data can be used for governance, growth and public welfare. So that is the question. If this is the question, you see in this question, we can write an introduction by talking about the, first we can talking about the importance of data. Importance of data and the recent development of many technology or fourth industrial revolution. Fourth industrial revolution is mainly data driven. And we can talk about the various recent technologies like artificial intelligence, data analytics, then data science, then we are having machine learning. So then we are having blockchain technology, all these technology, then we are having Internet of Things. All these technologies are dependent on data, which is going to revolutionize the governance and everything. We can talk about the recent, we can talk about the importance of data in the introduction about the recent industrial. So we can write the introduction like this. The fourth industrial, the world is about in the verge of facing the fourth industrial revolution. So data is going to be the main fuel for this fourth industrial revolution. Like that, we can give an introduction. Or we can write an introduction in another way by talking about the recent increase in the data production in India. Recently, how data production and consumption increased in India, which is giving us the huge scope for the potential. So you could see here that recently government launched this Jandan Aadhaar Mobility or Open Government Data Platform or National Judicial Data Grid. And this is another statistic which is giving, which is talking about number of mobile users got increased. You can draw these diagrams also. Number of mobile users increased from 349 million to 600 million. Number of internet users also almost tripled. Number of digital Aadhaar number users also increased. And UPI transaction is also, there is a huge increase between the 4 months. You can quote any of this data or you can draw any of this graph in your answers. So these kind of graphs will give you the good introduction to talk about the importance of data. Now then what we can do, the next part of the question after writing the introduction, the next part of the question, you can talk about the like directly importance of data in governance, how data can be used for governance. Then another part of the question is how data can be used for growth and public welfare. So you can write growth separately and public welfare separately. So what is the difference between growth and public welfare? With respect to governance, you can talk about how this data and online platform can be used to improve the governance, how it can be used to improve the transparency and all those things. Here you can talk about the Jandan Aadhaar and mobile connectivity. Through this, we are getting a lot of data. We are also identifying the beneficiaries properly and saving a lot of money. So like that, you can write. So by bringing in the judicial data grid, the entire operation of the Supreme Court and High Court will be streamlined, and the case completion can be done in a quick way. So all these things you can write. By digitization of land records, you can collect more taxes, and you can also allocate the land to the people and the needy. So with respect to growth, how the data management can propel the economic growth? How economic growth will be propelled? When there is more production, when there is more investments, when there is more financial inclusion, like this. So we can address all these aspects. With the help of good data, you can do all these things. And then we can talk about public welfare. Public welfare means you can talk about the social justice or health, how health and education can be taken to people through this data and management. So we can write those part of the answer, and you can write the in the last part, instead of conclusion, you can write the way forward. In way forward, you can write how data can be made a resource. Like in way forward, you can talk about. So actually, before writing way forward, you can also write about the challenges. Challenges before the government in order to use the data efficiently. Like we are not having a privacy law, and then there is no awareness about privacy among the people. So government is not bringing in a separate policy in order to deal with the data of the citizens and all those things. We can also talk about this DESA initiative of Niti Aayog. And in way forward, you can write that we have to correct all these issues in order to make it efficient. So like that, we can write and we can end the answer. Okay, so this is how we can structure it. And please study that DESA, okay, data empowerment and security architecture. You just type DESA and Niti Aayog, and you will be getting Niti Aayog UPSC. You just search it and you will be getting various articles. You just study what is the framework given by Niti Aayog. You can code those things also. In that document itself, they have discussed all the potentiality of the data, and they also discussed about the challenges, and they also gave the way forward. All these three things is being discussed in this one particular report. It is just a 20-page report. You don't need to study fully. You can just read the executive summary of the report and take any diagrams possible. Actually, I took this diagram from that report only. This diagram was taken from that report only, and you can do that. Okay. So, okay, guys, with this note, we have come to the end. So with this, we have come to the end of the today's session. Since there is a power outage, I might be looking sitting in the dark room. So it is a power outage here. I'm using the mobile data to do this session. So since we are not having the data capacity, what we can do, if you are having any doubts, you can post it in the comment section. Once the live is over, the video will be available in our channel, and you can post any doubts in the comment section, not in the live chat, but in the comment section. I will address all the doubts posted in the comment section. Okay. Now, let us not have this live doubts session. Okay. So thank you, guys. Thank you for coming to this session. So we will be continuing this session from Monday to Friday. And on Saturday, we'll be having the editorial session. So this is how it is going to go. So we'll meet on next week in another Good Morning.